Hello everyone, welcome back to the Legal Saints, and this is the crux note of Kelsen's Pure Theory of Law and HLA Hart's Theory. Alright, so both the theories are very often asked. Let's give you the overview of it so that you have a little idea of what to include in your paper while answering the questions on this particular topic and what not to write, okay, what to avoid. So let's get started. So these are the, you know, the topics, the divisions in which we'll be talking about, all right, the breakdown of the chapter. All right, so on the basis of oughts, this oughts refers to what law is and what law ought to be, ki kaisa hona chahiye. So on this basis, you know, Hans Kelsen divided legal science from natural science, right? Austin's notion of law as command has been heavily criticized by him. Okay, so Kelsen's Pure Theory of Law basically talked about new legal ideology, okay, and he said, you know, that it is the law is as it is, okay. He talked about that, and he said, he proposed that it is free of all ideologies. All right, so he wanted to look at the law in a most basic form, and on the following premises he based his pure theory, right? So he started with a few assumptions, and here is a breakdown of what he included in his pure theory. He said that he felt that a legal theory should always be based on the law as it is, rather than the law as it should be. He believes that a theory of law must be valid at all times and in all places. That means that it should be, the theory of law should be universal. All right. Okay, so when he says this, that, you know, there should be a universal theory of law, so he was a proponent of broad jurisprudence, and he also believed that the theory of law should be pure. That means, you know, being free from all the other field, from the influences of external fields, right? Next, he argued that law is a normative science and that legal theory should focus on the consequences of legal norms. All right, now he'll talk about, you know, one of the basic things that we'll talk about here is the Grund norm. Okay, so Grund norm is the basic norm. All right, example, in the case of murder, legal science would always discuss the appropriate sentence for the perpetrator. It would always make a reference to what should be done in accordance with the law. He goes on to claim that there is a hierarchy of such oughts. Now this he is, you know, Kelsen, he goes on to claim that there is a hierarchy of such oughts that originates from a single ought, known as the Grund norm, in every single legal system, right? So the Grund norm is the basic, the, you know, the base of the pyramid that is there. All right, so on from which he believed that even criminal and civil emerged from this particular Grund norm. All right, then we talk about the Grund norm a little. All right, and then we move on to his criticism. Okay, so it is said that, you know, he did not maintain it in a clean manner, like his pure theory was not actually very clean. So the implication of pure theories are as follows. He said, you know, there was no distinction between public and private law, because he said, you know, the Grund norm is the base and each branch of law emerges from the from the same. So the source of both of them is the Grund norm, and it is not the concept of right that is important here, but the concept of obligation in Kelsen's pure theory. Every standard has an aspect of ought that demonstrates this. Law only uses personification as a technical tool to attain its aim as a normative science. As a result, for the purposes of learning law, the distinction between natural and juristic individuals is immaterial. And then the next one is the contrast between procedural and substantive law is a matter of degree, okay, with procedural law being more important, right? The boundary between a legal and a factual question is arbitrary, he said. I mean, that is what his theory implied. A judge's assumption about what must have happened in order to apply a certain norm is called a fact. Okay, so the fact was turned into a judge's assumption, right? Kelsen did not believe in the separation of powers, arguing that the three branches of government, that is legislative, executive and judiciary, are necessary norm creating institutions, because yeah, one applies the law, one creates the law, and the other one interprets the law. So yeah, they basically emerge from the same source. Okay, so the implications are these. We come on to criticism of, you know, Kelsen's pure theory of law. And you know, although he has been praised that, you know, there are less of complexities as compared to Austin's, you know, positivistic school. However, you know, the norms, the grand norms that he talks about is quite uncertain in nature, right? And, you know, there is this Professor Lasky who stated that, you know, granted it's postulates, I believe, the pure theory to be unanswerable, but its substance is an exercise in logic, not in life. Alright, so that means it, you know, it lacks practicality as far as the application of the pure theory is concerned. Okay, however, aap isko tark vitark karke, okay, it's quite theoretical. So, the application is there in the logic, in the theoretical part, but not in the practical things, right? That is what Professor Lasky said. Moving ahead to the next topic of the session, which is HLA Hart's theory. Now, Hart is often called, you know, to be the face of the British positivism. Although John Austin started with this school, all right, positivistic school, analytical school, okay, but still Hart is given the credit. All right. Now, to challenge Austin's analytical theory, okay, or the positivist theory, he evolves and he employs the two concepts of power and rule, all right. And he researched about law, he proposed a theory on basis of the rules, okay. Rules as in rule, those rules that are primarily enforceable, that can be actually literally enforced. Now there he categorized the rules into two types, one being the primary, the other one being the secondary rules. Okay, primary one being also called as the fundamental rules, right? So here is the little brief of primary and secondary rules. So we see about, then we analyze both of them, which is defects in primary rules and then uncertainty, static character, all right, the inefficiency of primary rules. Then we come to the remedies for defects, that how it can be cured. So there are different rules like rules of recognition, adjudication, all right. And then we come to the internal aspect of law, all right. So here we see, you know, that apart from, you know, external influences, that the law should also be, you know, law is also influenced by the internal causes, all right. The people must voluntarily obey a law, okay. So it's not only that, you know, societal pressure and other things, the sanction, command duty sanction, what we see in Austin's theory, it's not only that, but there are some intrinsic causes, the internal aspect of the law and its application. And then we move on to the criticism of Hart's theory, wherein, you know, the major criticism was regarding his concept of interior aspect of law, which he describes as uncertain and immeasurable, obviously, because, you know, it cannot be measured and it cannot be predicted, actually. That is why it is, you know, very uncertain and immeasurable. And then some comments from other professors in the row, and we end our answer here. That is what we do. This is how we write and break down the answer on pure theory and HLA Hart's theory. See you in the next one. All the best for your exams. Make sure that you subscribe to the channel.